Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in to this week's classic episode of Angler West TV. This week we're going to the Rogue River, the Lower Rogue, where we'll troll herring with spinners for salmon, plus do a little steelhead fishing. And then it's up to Shasta Lake for some good old-fashioned trout fishing. Now stay tuned, we're going to the Rogue River right now.
Hi everybody, I'm Al Linder and welcome to Angler West Television.
Southern Oregon's Rogue River runs through some of the West's most beautiful and rugged landscapes until finally reaching its mouth at the Pacific Ocean at Gold Beach. Today, I'm with guide Toby Bowman and also Richard Nedros, Gary Morales, and Doug Nedros of K-Wine Radio in Ukiah. We're running to the mouth to fish for Chinook salmon after launching at the Kimball Creek Lodge and RV Park about 8 miles upstream. On the way, Toby stopped to show us a special spot on the river.
This is the first holding hole when the Chinook come out of the estuary where the salt water ends at high tide is right here. This is a deep hole, and the salmon will stage in here and acclimate to the water temperature of the river because it's going to drastically go up to about 72 degrees. So the fly fishermen, they'll put little pram boats right here, and they'll have a hog line right here, and they'll start casting for the salmon right here. And the world record was caught on 8-pound leader on a fly rod, 71 pounds.
Wow.
It took them about an hour. That fish towed them all around here and then took them to shore.
That's a beauty.
Yeah.
I kind of doubt we'll catch a 71-pounder on 8-pound leader today, but any fish we do catch will be bright and fresh, right out of the ocean. The standard bait for this part of the Rogue is frozen anchovies rigged with a spinner. This type of bait is commonly used on the West Coast, but the Rogue has its own unique preferences.
This river, compared to most rivers, like a slow spin. This river likes a tight spin. Tighter the better, the less of the flop on the tail. They like a fast spin on this river. It outfishes all the slow spins, 3-1. So we try to get the bait to run as tight as possible. And this is a Rogue River setup, a little spinner bait blade in front of the anchovy. I have about 7 beats so the blade doesn't touch the nose of the anchovy. And it's a nice attraction. Works good here. Chartreuse is definitely the color. And hopefully we'll catch some fish today.
While there were quite a few boats in this area near the Highway 101 bridge, obviously the bite hadn't turned on, as we fished for quite a while without seeing any signs of salmon. But also, it didn't appear that anyone was even thinking of giving up early.
Basically, we're waiting for the tide to come in. As the tide comes in, it brings in the bait, and as the bait comes in, the Chinook will follow. And as the bait goes out, the Chinook will follow them out. So there's some fish that stay in here through overnight, but most of them come in on the tides to follow the bait, and then they'll follow the bait back out on the outgoing tide. And so there's a bite on the incoming tide and usually on the outgoing tide. This week, they've been biting on the incoming tide mid-morning. Today, it'd probably go off between 12 and 1 o'clock. So hopefully, they'll come in on the tide, follow the bait in. And if the bait comes in, usually there'll be a large amount of salmon that comes in. If the bait don't come in, it's going to be one here, one there today. But the bait's been coming in all week, so hopefully this is going to get going in about an hour.
That's all she wrote.
So help me Kimball Creek.
With great anticipation, we continued to troll the area, but the appearance of a large ship possibly presented the fishermen with a problem.
Okay, the Corps of Engineers are here dredging the mouth of the Rogue River. Each winter, the river floods and the sand fills in, and if he didn't come here, the bar across would be about 3 feet deep. And he opens up a channel so we can navigate outside. And without him, we couldn't get outside. So he's here. He gives us about 5 days a year. This year it was extremely bad, so they're giving us 9 days to open up about a 20-foot channel at the mouth of the river. don't like seeing him here. I like seeing him here before we start trolling here, but when he does come, it stirs it up, and sometimes the fish don't want to come in because he's stirred it up. But yesterday he was here and the fish came in, so hopefully they'll come in today.
Not the mouth, but the lower jaw. So we keep the front hook, keeping it shut. Pull the line through. Wrapping around the hook. Flip it over. Take the flat part. Put it right here and wrap it around the backbone. Place the front hook. Just when I start to feel the tip come out, that's about it. And I wrap this right up the eye right on the nose like that. Bend the tail down a little bit, pull the tail down a little bit. It's a paper fastener, it's a little clip that holds that front hook in. There you go. Rogue River Special. Toby! Toby! It's running!
Before long, Doug Nedros had his hands full with a fresh and very hot Rogue River salmon.
Come on, Doug. Go in. How's your bag all there?
It's tight. Good job. Nice fish.
Oh, that's work. That was, whoa. That's too much work for no man. Oh.
Here we go. Nice fish. That'll work.
I thought I had a 45 pounder on. It was about, how much, 20 pounds?
Right about
20 pounds. And I had that line drag set as tight as I would want it. And that was a fight. That wasn't fun. That was work. But boy, I tell you, when they hit, they run. In fact, if Toby didn't run the main or run the kicker and chase it, it would have spooled me. I mean, when they come in here, I don't know what it is. They come in from the ocean and they get in this river, I don't know, but they're hot. They're really hot. And I don't want to catch no more today.
We all wanted to spend some time in some very pretty stretches of the river upstream from Kimball Creek, where there's a possibility of hooking a summer run steelhead. So Toby took us for a boat ride past Kimball Creek Lodge, which by the way is a fantastic place to stay when fishing the Rogue River. And don't forget your golf clubs, as there's a course on the park-like premises. Call 1-888-814-0633 for reservations. It was a spectacular jet boat ride through steep canyons and thick forest, well worthwhile, even if we didn't hook any steelhead. But something tells me it's going to be our lucky day.
Under the boat.
How's the drag on this?
That's fine.
Oh, it's an adult.
That's a nice size.
Oh, this is... Uh-oh.
Do you have a steelhead? Is it a steelhead or size?
Yeah, adult steelhead.
For God, that a baby!
Hey. I've never caught a steelhead in my life. I've fished for them a lot.
That's about a 6-pound steelhead. That's a good size.
All right, look at that baby. That a baby.
Is this a coconut on this here?
Does he have an adipose fin? Can you tell?
On that rock.
Oh, he's beautiful. I'm gonna let him go. There you come, big boy. Good job. There you go. He's wild too.
He's down there swimming, Sam.
Catch and release. Very good, Toby.
That was fun.
Hey, Toby, I think we better go do that again.
You want to go do that again?
Okay.
Hey everybody, hope you're enjoying this week's classic episode of Angler West TV, where we just finished up on the Rogue River fishing a herring dressed up with a spinner. Now that's a setup that you can easily create yourself. We have all the components here at the shop and I'll show you. First thing you need obviously is the spinner. We've got lots of different colors and sizes. If you're just getting into this and you just want to try one, I would suggest the chartreuse and green dot. That's a great place to start. You also need some beads. Now, Toby, in the episode, he says he uses 7 beads on that particular setup, and that's probably about right. Another way you can go, besides just using individual beads like this, is the Max Lure stacked beads. So this is a stack of different size beads stuck together. So it's very simple to string. Really makes that sort of setup easy. If you need it a little longer, you can always just add another bead. So this is a great way to go. Then you also need a clevis. Now, a clevis is what the spinner actually spins on. You got some options there. These are the old fixed clevises, brass clevis, great quality. With these, you can't change your spinner without tearing the lure apart. So some people really like that because they don't trust the interchangeable spinners because they think they're gonna lose their spinner. So they go with these. Now, if you're like Toby, you know, he was using these basic white plastic interchangeable clevises. Lots of people use these. It's a simple, inexpensive way to go. You know, some people don't trust them because they think the spinner's gonna come off, you know, and occasionally they might on this. But these are a good way to go, and some people really do prefer these over any other clevis. Now, what I've got here is the Oregon Tackler, OTM, interchangeable clevis. Now, these are great because they're strong, your spinner's not gonna come off, and it's very easy to use. In fact, I asked Max Lure to build the Scorpion Salmon spinner with Oregon Tackle clevises. So both spinners are on OTM clevis. Because you buy this lure, and then maybe you don't want a silver blade. Maybe you want to go to a painted blade. And we have all the blades in stock individually packaged like this. So you can modify your lures, and it's very simple. You just grab your blade and pull it off. Put whatever blade you want on there. And that's all there is to it. These Scorpion spinners, by the way, are made with not too kinky titanium wire, which back when Gary Morales was first building this lure, this was a Shasta Tackle product originally. I'm the one that suggested that he use this stuff because this stuff's great. You know how you catch a big fish on a spinner like this and it gets all twisted up and bent and you might only get one fish on a spinner. Well, these, you know, you can bend them all you want and they're just gonna pop right back in shape. Great idea. Now, Up next, we're gonna go to Shasta Lake with Gary Morales, who made this scorpion salmon spinner I just mentioned, and Steve Lynch from ProCure, way back when ProCure just introduced the super gels. Now, since then, ProCure has expanded their product line dramatically and come up with all kinds of great stuff. Now, super gel's done super great. You know, for me, if I'm like jigging for lingcod or something, then the super gel, which is super sticky, it's gonna stay on. That's what I want. Other times, I've kind of grown to like this super sauce, which isn't quite as sticky. It's basically the same scent, but it's just not quite as tacky, you know, and washes off easier, and I think disperses into the water real well. And this particular one, the herring, is something that I wouldn't personally go anywhere near a buoy 10 without. I've had real good luck with this one there. And then, of course, there's the oils, which were around before the super gels. And these are great for marinating or injecting with an injector like this, or putting in corn or anything like that. Very useful. Now, more recently, they've come up with the water-soluble oil, which is the same oil, but it's been processed through a machine that actually makes it water-soluble. You know, water and oil doesn't mix. Well, this is oil that does mix with water. So it stays down the water column. It just doesn't float to the surface. Love this stuff. Now they've got it in a spray pump, so you can spray it on feathers or anything, and it doesn't mess up your feathers. It's great. Now, another thing that's come out recently, this is actually a Yakima bait product, but the rooster tail scent spray, which is made by ProCure. So I'm sure the base of it is water-soluble oils. I'm not exactly sure what else they put in this, but man, this stuff is good. I like to spray it on top of, say I'm putting a little super gel or sauce on a lure, I like to spray this on top of it. I've had good luck doing that. But if you're fishing any kind of a jig with feathers, like the Rockstar jig or a rooster tail, this is great stuff. Now, stay put, because we're going to head up the Shasta Lake in the wintertime to do some trout fishing up next.
I'm Justin Wolf.
And I'm Roland Martin, and you're watching Angler West Television.
Shasta Lake is an outstanding wintertime fishery, and today I'm with Gary Morales of Shasta Tackle Company and Steve Lynch, general manager of ProCure Bait Scents, who's on board to introduce Gary to ProCure's new line of super gel scents.
Now we just hooked up, what, 20 feet we were down there. And it feels like a rainbow. It's not a real big fish. We're pulling a little.
Shasta Lake has a good population of native Pitt River strain rainbows, but this one looks like one of last year's planters.
Pretty fit.
Yeah, nice chunky fish. It fought well. Been eating good. Now I'll set that fish go. Get that orange gold, or that golden black color. We were down about 20 feet with that one. Oh, we got one over here. All right, there you go. That feels like a good fish.
Thank you, Gary.
Yeah. Boy, we just scented that up. What scent did we put on that?
We put the threadfin shad.
Oh, that's perfect. That was that shad imitation humdinger, that black and white one. You know, I was telling you about how we rigged these up a little different. You've been fishing humdingers for what? Quite a few years. We've known each other for a long time. Yeah, you could tell the difference in that lure when you tie them direct and then up to the swivel. That's a good fish.
Yeah, I've been fishing them wrong. I've been tying mine right to a plug snap.
Yeah. It makes a difference to just tie them direct like that. And we're using 6-pound tests, and you can see, you know, we're not breaking the fish off even with 6-pound there. But yeah. Let me get the net. This looks like a pretty good fish.
I think we're going to be all right now. Oh, that'd be embarrassing. Yeah, I'm in the shore.
All right. Here we go, let's get this fish. Oh, pretty trout. There we go. Think I got a
beautiful
long enough
fish.
Net.
Gary, can I see how you have that tied up, correct?
Yeah, see? It's just...
you just make a small loop.
Just a loop knot. Okay. And if you look real close at that humdinger, you can see it's kind of red on the belly.
Yeah.
I put a little fingernail polish on there to make it have a kind of a blood line.
All right.
And that actually... this time of year, that seems to help a little, too. Yeah.
So does that threadfin gel.
Yeah, that gel did the job.
Gary, is that the average-sized trout for the lake?
Well, that's a typical rainbow out here. You know, we'll get them up to about 4 pounds, but most of them run right into that 15, 16 inches.
Oh, that's a beautiful fish.
Yeah, let's let it go here. There he goes.
Nice release.
Strong fish. He's coming to get that fish.
Ooh.
Oh, look at that. Oh, that's awesome. It looks like our fish didn't quite get down quick enough. Let's put that back down and get some more of that, that shad gel on there.
Put a little of the thread fin gel just on the back side of the lure so it doesn't take away from any of the paint.
There you go.
And that'll stay on for about 30 minutes until you catch your next fish.
There it is. It didn't take long the last time. It wasn't out there but 5 minutes.
Yeah, I don't even think that. These are brand new super gels.
Yes.
These are just fresh out on the market. This is the same ProCure, you know, real products. That's pure shad ground up.
Yeah.
We just put it in with a gel base. So unlike the butters, you know, where it's just for certain water temperatures, this will work from freezing cold water all the way up to 80 degree temperature.
Well, I can tell just the way it stays on the hook there, that's going to work great.
Yeah. It's real bait ground up. So, I mean, we're putting the real sin out in the water.
That's what I've always liked about ProCure, because it's the real thing. You know, there's nothing artificial there.
Yeah, we're the only company that I know of that processes real bait and starts out with our base.
That same lure, that thing hit hard. Whoa, it's back there too.
So it's the topwater rods are getting hit.
Yep, right on top today. Well, the water temperature is 55 degrees, which is ideal for them. Man, it's hard to do a little segment here, isn't it?
Yeah.
Get those lures out there and fish on. I tell you what, that shad gel is doing the job. You know, I use the gels and I've used the oils and the butters. Now, the gel being new, what's the advantages there, and when do you use one over the other?
Well, you should be using the gel. If you're fishing lures or soft plastics, you should be using the gel base. That's a brand new super sticky design we've just come up with. And that'll stick great for your soft plastics and lures. But if you're injecting baits or marinating baits, you want to be using the oil.
Okay. Oh, he's taking line. Look at this fish go. Oh, darn. You see that thing take off?
Yeah.
That was a nice fish. Doggone it. Well, that happens, those big fish. When they start fighting like that.
That hit that hard.
Oh, it did. It was a nice fish. I bet you that fish was pushing 3.5 pounds.
Wow.
That was a beauty. Oh, well. We had that, what? Wasn't even out there 2 minutes.
Not really, yeah.
Boy, that very gel's quick. Doing the job. And
the gel's still on there. You really don't even need to reapply it. You can smell the gel. It's still on
it.
Yeah.
That fish didn't even take that off of there.
I still like to apply another batch with each fish.
Always. Anytime that lure comes in, I want to put more scent on it.
That's right.
Especially the way they're all over this thing. You know, I honestly think that gel's working better than the oils in that I used to use all the time.
Well, correct. The oil won't stay on the lure long enough. I mean, the oil is probably gone within 3 minutes.
There you go.
The gel is what it's designed for, the lures. It will stay on this cold water, warm water, really won't make a difference.
It's great. I mean, I can tell already that's going to be my number one product there.
Yeah. So unless you're injecting baits or trying to marinate a bait, you really don't want to be using the oils if you're fishing lures or soft plastics. The same thing if you're using jigs. You should be using the gel with jigs.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if you jig much for kokanee
but... Not really. Very few people out here do any jigging. It's mostly trolling.
Okay. Well, ideally, the gel would be the thing to be using out here for the conditions I've seen today.
Well, I can tell you, this is working real good today. I'm loving it.
Yeah.
You know, it's December, and it's really a nice day, and we're back in on the west side of Ski Island. We've been pulling some trout out of here. Most of the fish have been coming in from the surface down to, about 20 feet or so. In fact, we got some fish right now. They're down about 75 feet. Let's give that a shot. Let's go out and see if we can get one of those. Yeah, you never know, but most likely they're bass. But let's see what we can do. All right, there we go. Lure's back about 100 feet, so we'll be there in just about a few seconds here. That's great. I saw those fish on the screen at 75 feet, and I went down. And I hooked up, grabbed this one, you hooked up over there on the surface.
Yeah, my top rod arrived.
This has got to be a bass. I'll be shocked if it's a trout at that depth. I don't know, though. Oh, yeah, it's a bass. What's the spot? What's that tell you?
Beautiful fish.
Yeah. That's a chunky one too.
That's a nice. Pretty little rainbow.
Yeah. That hit that humdinger with the black and white shad pattern with that bloodline on there, with that Procure shad gel, threadfin shad gel. That's been a hot setup there.
That's been the ticket today.
Well, let's see if we can get this fish back in the water. Hopefully the eagles won't get this one. There he goes.
Oh, he's off like a rocket.
Boy, that's some cold water.
Hey, Gary, this has been a lot of fun.
No, it has, huh?
Yeah.
Good job.
Thank you very much. It's been a great day.
Had a good time.
It's been perfect.